The next topic is about phase appropriateness. And phase appropriateness relates to the rigor of analytical testing and specifications. There has to be a consideration of regulatory requirements, and especially with regard to method validation. I will talk about method validation a few slides from now. The stringency of the work you do is obviously going to be easiest at the beginning or early stage, and it has to be as stringent as possible as you're approaching commercial. Okay. This is just meant to be a thought list of what you generally need to do for covering yourself as you're putting your analytical packages together at different phases. There may be some variation around this, but just generally what should be done. So you have to characterize your molecule with identification tests. And whatever's appropriate is what you should use. And again, NMR, IR, compositional, elemental, whatever it takes to adequately define your molecule. And you need to have a primary method for assay or purity and impurities, typically chromatography, right? So you will have to consider other impurities like residual solvents, water. Loss on drying can cover those together if you're looking for a faster way. We have to look for ash or residue on ignition, and there may be a need to look for metals. So then going on, you also have to have some knowledge of the stability of the material. And I'm not going to talk about stability regulations, but I think as I understand it, you need to at least characterize, the tendencies of what your molecule is going to do under stress conditions. You should also look for a mass balance in what you get for a purity number and all the impurities you have. You want to make a best attempt as possible. It's recognized that not all response factors are the same for impurities you see on a chromatograph, and you may not always get 100%, but maybe you'll come close. And it's also important to know how impurities line up for multiple lots. I'll get into that shortly as well. When you get to phase two, you just got to elevate the stringency of what's needed. So for example, if you didn't have gas chromatography method for residual solvents, when you were working with phase one support, you need to have that by phase two. And you need to start thinking about validated methods for your product. And when you get to commercial, or phase three, when you're at phase three, as I see it, our customers tend to have a commercial mindset. There's a lot of planning on the drug product development side as well, but you do have a commercial mindset. And actually, you want to start validating your methods for even the precursors in your synthesis. And the definition of a precursor is starting materials, key raw materials, and intermediates. So just lumped together in one word. There's also a cleaning verification method that I'll touch on as well. So again, the overall rigor of test methods will increase as a project evolves. There are some phase-related guidances here. I just put them up as flags or reminders that these are things you can read into. To my knowledge, nothing says absolutely that you have to validate your methods at phase one or phase two. But industry practices seem to be, you validated phase two. From my own experiences working with customers and past projects, the FDA has actually said they wanted to see methods validated at phase two. Phase one, that's still where conservative and careful companies will want to validate at that stage. When we look at our customer base, it varies. Some customers don't want to put the money out to have methods validated. They're on a strict budget. And if it says, well, we don't have to, then why bother? So we advise, we coach, but we work carefully in that mode.